Hello everybody, in this video tutorial I'm going to show you how I am setting up a studio setup in Unreal for real-time ray tracing, DX12 and the RTX technology I'm going to use here, of course, an NVIDIA card that supports DX12. Just before we dive into that, I wanted to mention, please check out my other video tutorial in which I'm going to show you how to set up the RTX and DX12 ray tracing in your Unreal Engine for immediate success and also for immediate results here in your render viewport. So that being said, as you can see, this studio setup is fairly simple setup. It's in real time, as you can see, and it's working very, very well. The frame rate also, when you look at this, is very fast. You still have like 30 frames per second on this machine and everything is completely ray traced. And I'm going to show you how this studio setup is set up and how I usually do it. So first of all, I want to give you here a little bit an overview. When you look at this, you see nothing else than a sphere and of course a little chair, and in the background is a wall. I have a floor material, and there is also my logo on it. And when you click on the top upper part here, then you can also see, like, I can switch to wireframe, and as you can see, I just pulled up a few walls or planes, and it's very simple. It's a very simplified scene file. And how I usually start is basically, you know, bringing in some lights, and you will also see that I'm going to use standard lights that are implemented, that is coming automatically with the Unreal Engine. And when you push the button G, then you can turn on or turn off, so to speak, the additional items, so you can see what is going on in your scene file. And all those little icons, etc., are showing you what is in this scene file really set up and what's going on. So I will go through this step by step with you, and I will show you how this studio setup is really, really done from ground zero. So the first step I usually do is, let's say you have created a ground plane, and I'll show you here on the basics, you can also go and drag and drop a plane, and you can see when it's coplanar, okay, that means the two geometry objects are at the same level, then they start flickering in the viewport. But you can drag this up a little bit, and then you can see this is just a simple plane. And I will also show you, of course, how I am going to assign shaders, etc. But this could be just, you know, a simple floor. And then by pushing the button W, you can control objects by moving things. E is for rotation. Control C, you can undo things. And R is for scaling. And as you can see, this is fairly simple and quick and easy done. And the first thing I want to show you is just like, I don't want to go into like importing objects or geometry. I just really dive into how the lighting is set up, how the post-process volume is set up, and what are those things doing. So as you can see, if you hit the button G, then the icons are disappearing, and if you turn them on, then you see something is coming in. So what are those icons? First of all, you see here this little pink, now yellow, when you select it, wireframe, and it's a box. And this box, when you select it, it's going to be highlighted in your world outliner. It's called post-process volume. If you would click here on the left side under the tab visual effects, you can also see that the post-processing volume is here. You can again drag and drop this, and it would basically be entering your scene file. Yeah, so I delete this one here because I already created one. And when you click on it, you can see in the outliner now it's selected, and under the details section you can see all the properties and features. And the post-process volume is very, very important, because with this, you can also activate ray tracing. You can, specify the depth of field, the lens in general, and it as you specified, it goes basically on, it is assigned to the entire scene file, in this case called level. And of course, you can here change things. So for instance, if I see lens flare, if I have a lens flare in my shot, I can change the intensity and you might see it. But in this particular case, my camera or my viewport angle doesn't show this. Color grading, for instance, you can, for instance, change immediately on the fly, like in real time, the temperature, as you can see. You can tint the shot in a certain way, as you can see here as well. If I change here the values, then it is assigned immediately. And one thing that is also very, very important, what I usually do the first when you select this post-process volume, this tiny little box basically is a container that specifies how far this post-process volume should actually be assigned to or should be active. And this is the space that post-process volume should usually act. But what I do is, if you type in unbound, and you can also, so to speak, basically scroll down, you see if I uncheck this unbound, then this post-process volume doesn't affect the entire scene, because if I check it, then it's unbound and it goes everywhere. It would only apply then inside of that cube, what you can see here that's going to be visualized. So that means that's very, very important. If you scroll down, I think unbound is it's on the very, very bottom somewhere here. As you can see here in post-process volume settings, it's infinitive or infinite extent. So you want to unbound it, that it's going to be applied everywhere. When you scroll through this, you can clearly see that inside of this post-process volume, there is a lot going on. And basically, you can do a lot of things in rendering features. That's very important, but also in coloring features and in the camera features. And you know, when you basically want to make changes here, as you can see in the temperature of the white balance, everything is going to be assigned in real time. And it's very, very cool because you can see the results instantly. So that's very, very great. But the bottom line is, the reason why I am, first of all, using the post-process volume is because I want to make sure that my ray tracing is actually turned on. Ray tracing for ambient occlusion, global illumination and reflections, and of course on top of it also for translucency, which is refraction, so for glass materials. But let's get started and let's dive into the settings of the post-process volume. You click ray, and if you do so, this is basically the shortcut for all the retracing, then you can see here that you have retracing ambient occlusion, you have retracing for the GI or so-called global illumination, you have the retracing for reflections and also translucency. Since I don't have any refractive materials in here, so there is no translucency like on a glass sheet, etc., I basically turned this off, and you see here my settings for fast results. I'm usually using for the beginning and without rendering a movie animation or whatever, just 1 pixel per sample. So that changes the performance. If you increase samples, the retracing engine needs samples to resolve the pixels. And if you would increase those samples, you can max it out here with 64 in the ambient occlusion, but also, of course, for instance, here in the GI. When you do that, you will see that you're losing frames per second. Okay, so that means the scene file is slowing down. The quality goes up of the materials. So basically, noise is going to be reduced, but at the same time, the frames per second are going down. So I keep this always at one sample at the beginning, because I don't even need anymore. Especially in the global illumination, you can also see here, very, very important that you have bounces. So usually you have primary and secondary bounce in offline renders and retracers. In this particular case, it's the engine works a little bit different, but it tells you that if you use more bounces, the bounces of the rays are higher, and you know it affects, of course, then also the look and the intensity and the strength of the global illumination. You will see this then later on in other tests I'm going to show you. And also here, the quality speaks for itself. How many samples would I like to use per pixel? As higher you go, as better is the quality, but frames per second performance is going to suffer, okay? And then you can also control your reflections. It's basically the same. And you have additional features, like in this particular case, you see it immediately on the reflections here on the sphere. This is a chrome shader, and it's going to use a lot of reflective values, right? And the max roughness would mean it's fully reflective, and you want the engine to support it, that you have all the values you need to get maximum quality of the shaders you build. But keep in mind also in this particular case, if you want to have full support and you put this to 1, then of course, you know, the frames per second, it always hits performance. So as more quality you want to have, as more accuracy you want to have, as more samples per pixel you add, it suffers on performance. But even so, when I look at this and I have more than 30 frames per second, I can say for me it's super fluent, it goes fast enough, and I don't have any problems. Even if you click the play button and you would go in actual game mode, then you can see here, and sorry, I have another audio here in the background, but it goes super quick and super fast, and it works brilliantly. I mean, it's like, it's really a blast. So again, going back here in my outliner, selecting the post-process volume either through the world outliner or in your viewport in the editor itself by just selecting the grid. So unselected, it's pink, and selected, it's turning into yellow. Then you will also notice that you always have under the details here a filter section. So as soon as you type something in, you limit the selections here, and you can control in the post-process volume what is under ray, what can you find, what settings can you find actually under ray if you type this in, for example. So let's continue here. So as you can see, I am retracing, so to speak, ambient occlusion. I am retracing reflections and GI, and if you turn this off, then usually if the lighting setup isn't very well supported, you would see dramatically different results in a studio setup, especially in an exterior shot where you might have only one light source, like the sun, and light is bouncing a lot, right? Then you will see a significant difference actually in the output. In general, when you look at the settings, and I refer to those settings always as I have, I also say in the retracing reflections you have in the shadows three different options. And as you can see, either, I mean, if you pick the first one, you don't retrace any shadows at all, and look at the difference here when you zoom in to the shadow underneath the chrome ball, you can clearly see that shadow isn't looking very smooth and very nice. But you can also turn on a hard shadow or hard shadows, and that is kind of like the fastest way to go, but it still doesn't look very nice. And the best shadows are area shadows. So if you turn this on, then you have actually the best quality of shadows. And when you compare this to none, then you can clearly see, okay, this gives me a very, very nice and smooth shadow solution. So for the beginning, this is basically it, what you really have to focus on in the post-process volume. Those are kind of like your render settings, if you will. Very, very important. And in my first video tutorial, I was talking about how to set up ray tracing in DX12. I want to show you again something very, very important. The project settings, they really do matter. So if you go into the project settings here on the top under settings and you click project settings, then you can type in ray again and you see the engine rendering needs to be turned on to ray tracing. If this isn't turned on, the whole DX12 and the ray tracing doesn't even work. And lots of people asked me this question before and said, Bernard, I turn on everything here, as you said, but I don't see any effects. I don't see any difference, you know, in my viewport. And everything looks the same. This is because you need to activate it here in the settings as well. And to double and triple check that your studio setup is really running in DirectX 12, hover over your project file here in the upper right corner and look under the graphics and double, triple check if it's really, really running under DirectX 12. As you can see here, this is what you would like to check. So the first step in the studio setup I'm showing here to you is basically having the right project settings and having the right post-process volume settings to get started with. So of course there are many, many other options, and this is, I have to say so, basically a preference, what you can do. I mean, for instance, if you want to have the bloom effect turned on and you say, I just want to have a really, really strong bloom. I mean, look at this. You can change the bloom right instantly. You see the bloom on the chrome sphere, and if you turn it off to zero, then there is no bloom at all. So if you go through this, then you will realize, okay, this is a preference, but I didn't touch that at all at the beginning. Maybe one important thing I like to use is, of course, the exposure settings. That is another topic in another video tutorial. I'm talking about camera work, camera sequence, about a physical camera especially. Because, you know, if you turn this off, the standard settings, it doesn't matter if you're using a camera or if you just look through the viewport here, is that the metering mode is set to auto. So you can do this, of course, here, and I'll show you again. If I set this to auto exposure basic, then you can see that the exposure is automatically trying to, you know, find a way to expose the current setup the correct way. You also see here that you can click then exposure compensation. So if you would add an exposure compensation to the auto exposure, you actually overexpose it, as you can see, and everything turns into a white burned out picture. You really don't want that. So maybe the good news is, if you are not familiar with camera settings and what adaptive field is, what, you know, the lenses you're choosing, what the shutter speed does to a film, ISO, etc., etc., then maybe the auto exposure settings is a good way to get started. But I'm also a DP or a digital photographer, a director of photography. I was working as a little kid already in, you know, the dark room, and I was, you know, developing old traditional film with the chemistry. And I love photography, and of course for me it's like a no-brainer to control everything manually, to have full control and to understand with what specific camera I am working with, and also, you know, what values I'm working with in terms of the intensity of the lights, etc., etc., etc. So this is very, very important, and you can check out my next upcoming video tutorials about camera work and the camera sequencer, in which I'm going to talk about that a lot as well. So, but let's keep the focus here. First step, post-process volume. As you can see, there is a lot of things going on, but what I usually do is to make this video tutorial more efficient for you and to have a quick start, I basically say check metering mode is manual, and then the exposure compensation, depending on the light intensity and in the studio environment, would be here maybe 16. And you can see if you change this to 10 or if you blow it up to 20, every step has a significant impact to the exposure of this specific scene setup. So this is basically the beginning You can also see there are more features in the post-process volume, for instance, like chromatic aberration. You can control here the strength. So if I go nuclear on this to show you the distortion, the chromatic aberration effect, hardcore on the edges, then you can see they look like rainbow colors, right? In film, of course, on TV, you have a small, very, very subtle effect on this. And I usually keep this very, very subtle. As you can see, maybe 0.02, if at all. And it's a post-process effect that you can assign in real time as well, and it goes super quick and fast. You have many, many other things, the dirt masks you can use on the camera. And as you can see, what I just mentioned, shutter speed, ISO, what f-stop are you going to use? Very, very important if you would like to control, of course, the depth of field. How many numbers of the blades you have, you can control, and so on, to control also the bokeh effect, and so on. So as you can see, the list is long, but to get started with and to understand what you really need at the beginning, this is it. Just a few, I would say, very, very important main options what you have to consider when working in Unreal for a studio shot up like this is, first of all, the post-process volume. And this is it for now. And maybe, of course, by the way, if you click G, this post-process volume, if it's unbound, it can be anywhere in your scene file, right? Wherever you would like to position that, of course, that's solely up to you. Again, click G, you turn the icons on or off, and it's really wonderful. It's super fast, it's quick. I mean, I'm a big fan from the Unreal Engine, the Ray Tracing DX12, and Epic Games. I think Epic Games did here a wonderful job for users as well, and designers, you know, and lighting artists, cinematography, visual artists. Like, I'm a guy, I'm more interested in all those kind of things, being creative than in developing. And great job from Epic Games here, what they did with this release and all the efforts, and combining the RTX technology and DX12. This is just wonderful. I would say a dream came true. So this is it for the first tutorial. Keep in mind, the next one is coming, so they're all following up, and I'll show you in my next upcoming studio setup. Of course, we are talking about the lights. We dive also into that. What are these lights doing? How can you set up something very quick and easy? And I will also cover some basics of the material. Later on, also geometry import options. Whatever you need to get started and to have something set up that looks really, really cool. Moves the needle fast. I hope you enjoyed this first video tutorial about the studio setup and the project settings and the post-process volume. Stay with me. If you like it, please, help me out. Click thumbs up, subscribe, and of course, visit my website, fedibull.com. You can download all those project files and demo files and other 3D scene files for free. Everything is for free because Fedibull believes in passion work. I believe in helping and giving. And if you also believe in that, then hop over to my website, fedibull.com, and sign up and get this free project. And then let's get started and let's jump into the next part of this wonderful series. Thank you so much. Happy retracing. Have fun. And welcome to fedibull.com.